Hi, I'm an anomaly here because I am not from any musical background at all. My name is Harish Iyer, and I'm going to speak to you about my life. I was I'm and I'm going to speak to you about an issue that you are not that you don't know about, okay? Everyone knows about it because in India there are 54% of boys and 51% of girls who get sexually abused. That simply means 50% of the population sitting over here has faced some form of sexual abuse, and boys more than girls. Okay? But we do not speak about it. In the country, if you really go to see, there are exactly three odd people whom I could count in my fingertips who speak about child sexual abuse. One of them happens to be me, who made it a mission in my life where I should be speaking about it. It's not a happy thing to go out and tell people, "Oh, you know what? I was sexually abused." But unless and until you speak about it and you tell people that, you know what, it's absolutely normal to live a normal life even after going through sexual abuse, you'll never have examples coming out, and you'll always think you have this stereotypical image about survivors of child sexual abuse, where we think that, okay, that person must be crying, or that person must be bitter, or anything of that kind. I'm none of those. Yes, I'm bitter about people who abuse animals. I'm bitter about terrorists and stuff like that. But I'm not bitter about life in general. I am as normal as y'all, and I'm as abnormal as y'all. Okay, so I was 7 when I was first sexually abused. The abuser was a male relative of mine, and he kept abusing me to an extent that if I was a woman, I would have been pregnant. When I grew a little older, when I was around 12 or 13, he used to get people home, and they all used to have sex with me. Many a times, I was asked to perform oral sex on people, and when I used to lick their penises, it was my own blood that I used to lick from that. So that's the state that I was in at that time. Especially when you go through abuse at a very young age. I mean, you'd see women who are in bitter marriages and who stay put with marriages for 10 years, for 15 years, and then they suddenly decide that, you know what, now no more. Okay? Yet, children who are undergoing sexual abuse, the first question that is asked to them when they turn adults and when they speak about it, "Why were you quiet for so many years?" In India, we do not have the culture about speaking about sex. In India, we do not call our private organs, we don't give names to our private organs. It's called chuchi, dinda, dindin. All these are kind of sweet names that are given to our private organs. My eye is an eye, my nose is a nose. And I'm proud to have a penis, and my penis is a penis. A vagina is a vagina, okay, and there's nothing to feel ashamed about. So, most often, children don't have the vocabulary to speak about sex abuse. Children don't have, you expect children to come and tell you things, but have you built that culture at home? Have you built that friendship at home with your children, that children could just come to you and tell you that, you know what, I've been sexually abused, I've been touched here, and that's all right? Many a times we are told by our parents, by our relatives, "Oh, he must have touched you like that. You must have misunderstood." Okay? If I am a man, I'm told, "Oh, why were you quiet for so many years? You should have bashed him back," because men are supposed to be macho. Men are supposed to be the abuser, not the abused. Okay? Because which is another problem. We think that every man is an asshole. Okay? And I believe in equal rights, and that's why I say that every man and every woman, both of them can be assholes, and every hijra as well. Okay? So, and there is a growing number of cases where women play the role of a sexual abuser. It's just coming out now. It's not that it never existed in our society. Okay? Never existed in our dharm and culture and all of that. It was always there. It's just coming out now. We have a culture of child sexual abuse, okay, and that's something that has to change. When I started growing up, obviously I was sexually abused, and I had this, you know, children who have sexually abused, you have this inner voice that talks to you, okay? And you live two lives, a life that you're sexually abused and the life that you're not sexually abused, and you don't want these two lives to meet. So I didn't want my life when I'm living, talking, speaking, studying, playing, I didn't want to remember about my sexual abuse. And somehow, logically or illogically, it was subdued. Whenever I had to go, and when I knew that my abuser and I are alone in the room, I used to remove my clothes and lie down. I never felt pain. He was a sadomasochist. He used to do lots of things to me, and I never felt pain. I only felt pain when I started wearing my clothes and I was walking off. I only felt pain when I was in school. I was standing in school, and when I found three students who were taller than me. I used to be very tall, and I used to thank my stars for it. And when I found three students who were taller than me, who stand behind me, and when I used to stand up because my back used to hurt. And I was reprimanded by my teacher because I stood up. It used to hurt me when I used to walk, okay, with a wobbly ass, and people used to assume that I am girlish. Nothing wrong in being girlish, okay, but people assumed, and because being girlish is as good as a swear, okay, I don't see it as a swear now, but at that time it was considered a bad word. And then when I started growing up, when I reached the age of 18, and when I moved on from school to college, I had one of my friends who went around in college, who was the only friend who knew about my sexual abuse, went around in college and told everyone that I was sexually abused. So then soon there was graffiti walls, everything that happens in a Hindi film. There were graffiti walls painted with my name for gay sex, contact Harish, my number. That time we had only landline numbers, thank God. Otherwise, I would have had so many phone calls. So I had a lot of these. My number used to be plastered everywhere, and we used to receive a lot of these obscene calls at that time, to an extent that I tried committing suicide. And I survived. Somehow or the other, I survived, and I survived only because of my dog. You bloody humans did nothing. Neither my mother. Every time I was being sexually abused, when my dog came into my life, his name is Jimmy, was Jimmy rather, because he's no more with me right now, in flesh and blood. In spirit, of course, he's with me. I used to put my head between his paws and start crying. And every time I cried, he used to lick my tears. That gave me courage. My dog gave me courage. And that's precisely why I am speaking out openly today, and I would speak openly till the last day of my life, is because I want to be Jimmy. I want to listen to people. And when I was growing up, I had my problems didn't stop there. In fact, till I was in school, it didn't bother me because I used to live these two compartmentalized lives. But when I moved to college, and when all this was happening to me, once I was in college and there was somebody who came up to me, and I was on stage, because stage was one thing. That's something that's common with Sheetal, Sandeep, and everybody, and me. Stage was something where I could let myself loose and be somebody else that I wouldn't have been otherwise. So there were two things that helped me. One was Sridevi, and the other was stage. I used to love her films. So once when I went on stage in college, I had the audience howling and screaming, saying gay, good, baila, chakka, hijra, and all of that. And I took the mic on my hand, and I said, I looked up and I said that I was 7 years old when I was sexually abused. And ma kasam, at 7 years of age, I enjoyed it. And I switched off the microphone, and I moved off. And the same crowd that was howling and whistling and teasing me gave me a standing ovation when I came out of the bathroom. crying with Amit, my eyes red and all of that, like a typical Hindi film heroine who that happens to her. So after all this, that's when my real battle began, because now I had 11 years, I was abused for 11 years. So I had 11 years of misery with me, and I had to let it out. So I used to speak to people. And when I used to speak to people used to tell me, "Are ye attention ke liye baat kar raha hai. He's using his sexual abuse to get attention." People tell me, even today, people tell me that I've got popular because I speak about my abuse. I said, "Of course, I love every minute of popularity, and I want everyone to get popular by speaking about something like this." But that became kind of a taboo. Then the other challenge that I started facing was, till that time, I didn't know what my sexuality was. I remember that when I used to be very young, when I used to watch Tarzan, Kimi Katkar wala Tarzan, where Kimi Katkar comes out of the water and she's all wet, and her breasts are being seen, and Tarzan touches her and feels her. Okay, and everyone in my house used to start salivating when they see something like that. And I used to look at Tarzan and say, "Oh my God, Tarzan is so hot." But I didn't know what was happening within me. And slowly and steadily, I started realizing that probably the thing that I thought, that I was bisexual, because I thought that I love women and I want to have children and all of that. Okay, but the thought of but the thought of entering a woman never passed my mind. And I used to spend hours together in the bathroom, masturbating, thinking about all the pretty women in the country, all actresses in the country and everything. But in the end, when I used to achieve orgasm, it was a man. So I knew that men are the cause of all problems, including my orgasm. So slowly and steadily, Satya. So slowly and steadily, I started speaking about me being gay. Okay, and for that, I had been to Singapore. I had sex with a commercial sex worker over there, with a woman, commercial sex worker. And it was a one-night stand, and it didn't stand at all. That's when I realized that I should stand for what I stand for. I do not want to live the life of a lie. I do not want to get married to a woman. When all people who tell me that I should get married to a woman, "Oh, this is abnormal and you should get married to a woman," I just tell them one thing: get your daughters married off to me. I could have sex and I can keep trying to have sex, but your daughter will live a miserable life. And if you can't wish that for your daughter, don't dare suggest that I do that with someone else's daughter. So I decided that I should speak up. And of course, then the question started. Then the question was, "Oh, is he gay because he was sexually abused?" That was a question that people started asking me. And now, to answer that, 54%, what I began my talk with, 54% of men gets a boys get sexually abused. If that was true, and most often the abuser is a man, that means homosexuality is we are not a minuscule minority, we are a major majority. Because 54% is more than, if everyone of them was supposed to turn straight, then that was the then we would be a major majority and not a minuscule minority. And secondly, all women, most women would have been touched, would have been felt up. Something would have happened with you all in your growing up years. Now, did you all turn straight because of that? I am gay because I'm gay. I am not gay because I didn't have any other way. I am not gay because I couldn't enter a woman. I couldn't have sex with a woman. I am gay because I like men. I am gay because I'm gay and I don't need any justification or any reason for it. I'm happy with men and I will continue making love to men, okay, irrespective of what the law tells us. Okay, I do hope that the law would change and so I could do something legally. Okay, till that time, not that I'm having sex every day. It's a dry day over here also. But yes, I just wanted to say that It is important that people don't judge people on what they do in their bedrooms. And it's not only homosexuality. Homosexuality is not illegal. Homosexual sex is illegal. Carnal intercourse against the law of nature is illegal. And that's not just homosexual sex. Any of you men, you're heterosexual, who believe in having sex with a woman and not entering the vagina, you're doing an illegal stuff, and you could be penalized under Section 377. Okay, so that means that 90% of the population of our country, which even masturbates because you're using an artificial orifice, okay, this is not your natural orifice. So technically, you're using an artificial orifice that you're creating with your hand. So all you men who masturbate are criminals, and you could be penalized. You could be penalized. I use the word penalized. You could be penalized and you could be put in jail. Okay, so Section 377 doesn't prohibit homosexuality. It is against carnal intercourse and unnatural sex. Sex for me is the most natural thing that has happened. I don't know who invented this unnatural word. Okay, so the law basically says that the penis can go only in the vagina, and go and keep your hand on your heart and tell me where all have the penis gone, and you will know that you all are criminals. Thank you very much.